Most people in Britain had never seen a Kenyan in the flesh, nor any other person with real black skin. If they weren't being portrayed as savages, then black people were most likely to be seen as harmless figures of fun. It is therefore not surprising that Britain's right to rule overseas wasn't seriously questioned. These attitudes were ingrained from birth. Every year, schoolchildren celebrated Empire Day.
I want to tell you, children, that you are, each one of you, a member of the Empire. And when you sing that you're proud of the Empire, I want you to feel that you're proud of yourself.
It was celebrated with songs, marches, and pageants, in which the tallest girl in the school dressed up as Britannia. The others, representing the countries of the empire, paid homage to their ruler. People would find reminders of Britain's world status in their everyday lives. You could buy exotic goods imported from the colonies, or visit an Empire theatre or cinema.
From Nairobi in Kenya comes another happy picture of British celebrations in a distant territory of empire.
The truth was that by the 1930s, looking after and defending such a huge empire was becoming difficult. A large part of the navy was employed to protect its far-flung territories, and a third of Britain's army was tied up in India alone. People in the empire were beginning to question Britain's right to rule them. And threats of this nature were dealt with harshly.
The garden party at Government House is the social event of the celebrations, which exhibit a characteristic temper of intense loyalty.
Back in Britain, though, the empire was shown to be peaceful, happy, and set to last for centuries. It didn't. The empire proved indispensable to Britain during the war.
Meanwhile, the war seems very likely to go east this winter. Already, there is action over a widespread front. In Kenya, for instance, where these AK-AK guns, manned by South African troops, are seen driving off an Italian reconnaissance plane. Treetop observation posts are, of course, well concealed from the enemy. The South African Air Force, which includes Hurricanes as well as Gladiators, is very much on the spot, and it's been dealing faithfully with the Duce's bombers and fighters. More and more troops keep arriving in these parts to reinforce our men. These two are South Africans, come to join their comrades in Kenya against the Italians. The war in Africa. Here on the Kenya front, many different types of men are defending the British Empire. Infantry from the Gold Coast, for instance, man this fort. The outpost contains a diminutive church, but not even here in the bush can a church escape the bombs of the enemy, it seems. A patrol is sent out from the frontier fort to scout for Italian patrols. I'm sorry to see that one man's having trouble with his army boots. South African artillery, having been informed of the position of the enemy patrol, goes into action from its well-concealed position, and assistance is given by the Air Force, which spots and bombs. There, on the left of the picture, you can see the enemy making off as fast as they can leg it. Now the tanks go forward to finish the job. Skirmishes and actions like this are a frequent occurrence over the wide African front. The big clash between Empire troops and Axis armies is still to come.
It provided ports, naval bases, and above all, soldiers. Africans, Asians, Caribbeans, Canadians, New Zealanders, and others fought enthusiastically side by side with the British. Even so, the old prejudices were hard for the British to discard. A Times article from 1940 concluded the African races were
considered to be the more backward of mankind, and yet they show the same spontaneity and true understanding of the issue. They know that the empire of which they are members is being challenged, and they are eager in their simple way to help in defending it.
Even when sons of Africa were dying for Britain, some people still could not bring themselves to see Africans as equals. After the war, Britain's grip on the empire began to slip. Britain was bankrupt and no longer a supreme power, able to control an empire. In this exhausted Britain, attitudes were at last beginning to change. People wanted to rebuild the country into a fairer society. Holding on to the empire didn't fit in with this. When the United Nations was formed, all countries, including Britain, agreed to a declaration of human rights, saying that all men and women, black and white, were equal.
Nation by nation, the delegates stand up for the great new charter they hammered out together. 50 nations standing side by side, unanimous for peace.
The idea of a small country like Britain holding on to a vast empire suddenly seemed out of step with the rest of the world. Back in Kenya, the Grants' fortunes were declining. Old Major Grant, a veteran of two world wars, died in 1947. Nellie keeps on the farm, but the Kenya around her is changing.
Tension between black and white was rising, but white settlers felt themselves immune to changing times.
I remember a settler saying to me, "You young district officers know nothing. We've been here for years. We know our boys, as they used to call them. We know the boys. We know all about them. You don't know anything." And it was a difference between knowing. The settler did know a lot. He did know a lot about Africans, how to handle African labour, how to use African labour. But he could not see what the use of that labour and the production of money was beginning to bring about.
Pathé News cameraman Bill McConville has been assigned to cover the news in the Kikuyu country, and this is his first report. The journey out was uneventful. A little girl played in the gangway. From the pilot came the report, all well, dead on course. Then suddenly we got our first glimpse of the wild mountainous land of the Kikuyu. Then Nairobi was below. BOAC had brought us to the heart of the Mau Mau territory in only 16 hours. The armed police soon showed us that the newspapers weren't exaggerating. You could feel the tension as soon as you set foot in the place. So this was Nairobi, the city of suspense, someone called it. It wasn't long before I saw why. Mau Mau suspects were being checked prior to interrogation. All were members of the Kikuyu, the tribe which has suffered most from the Mau Mau. Despite the fear that is in the hearts of all in Nairobi, they still go about their work as usual. But a loaded revolver in a man's or woman's belt told me just how great was that peril, and brought home to me for the first time the truth of those terrible stories of violence and sudden death. On the outskirts of Nairobi, I came across the Seven family. Brian, his sister Susan, and Mrs. Joan Seven. A gun was by her side as she read them a bedtime story. The next day at Karibanji, I filmed a large-scale roundup of men suspected of being involved in murdering 150 people in what they now call the Lari Massacre. I asked some of the officers about their job. They told me their chief problem was that so many Africans were reluctant to talk for fear of the Mau Mau's revenge, for even one of their own tribe may well be a member of the gang. A black cloud of suspicion hangs over all in Kenya, and until the Mau Mau are destroyed, the innocent too must suffer.
On October the 20th, 1952, the government of Kenya, supported by 40,000 white settlers and the British Army, declared war on 6 million Africans, and on the Kikuyu people in particular. The governor of Kenya announced that due to the widespread activities of the Mau Mau society, he had been forced to declare a state of emergency.
In Nairobi, capital of Kenya, Europeans and Africans still walk the streets in fear of the dreaded Mau Mau. Troops are in the streets of Nairobi. Sir Evelyn Baring, the governor, salutes the men of the Lancashire Fusiliers who have flown in to help clear his colony of the Mau Mau menace, which has struck fear into Kenya's very heart. Nairobi police have been supplemented by hundreds of civilians, many of them women, to help round up the Mau Mau bandits. Radio-controlled cars with armored vehicles are used to carry out the army's plans for bringing in all suspects. More than 3,500 have been arrested already. All have to be carefully checked by police security men, for in such a decisive swoop as this, it is all too easy for the innocent to suffer.
The emergency, which was expected to last for a few weeks, went on for 7 years. It took the lives of at least 15,000 Africans, none of whom could possibly have had anything to do with Mau Mau, for Mau Mau never existed.
Carry the mark of the Mau Mau must be hunted out so that peace may come to this troubled colony.
At the end of the Second World War, Kenya's Africans were impatient with colonialism. They had been ruled by Britain for 50 years with little to show for it. In the rural areas, they were confined to overpopulated reserves. In the towns, thousands were homeless. They were not permitted to elect their political representatives. They were forbidden to grow valuable cash crops. They were neither men nor women. They were natives. And in everything they did, they faced a color bar.
Let's be blunt. The Europeans, number one, Asians, number 2 1/4, Africans, number 4 1/2. They had no status at all. They were laborers, they were servants, they were what have you.
To the white settlers, this was home. They had created Kenya, and whatever Britain might want, they were determined to stay on top.
In 1922, Churchill gave the settlers a promise. He said, "This land is yours, the settlers, in perpetuity, not only for you, for your children and your grandchildren."
Originally, Britain wanted Kenya only as a link to areas deeper inside Africa. The Kikuyu, the largest tribe in Kenya, had been reduced to a narrow tribal reserve. Hemming in their growing population were the White Highlands. The capital, Nairobi, became a magnet for the Kikuyu, the most energetic and commercial of Kenya's tribes. While the British advertised farmland for white settlement, Kikuyu land hunger in their overcrowded reserve became intense. Among the tribes, they led the agitation for political change.
In an effort to change things, they now threw their support behind a mass nationalist movement, the Kenya African Union.
The political activity were terrific. we have aroused the political enthusiasm of the people throughout the country in order that they should fight for their rights.
But Kenya's white settlers were also impatient after the war. They were less than 1% of the colony's population. But for half a century, they had dominated its political and economic life. They had no intention of letting their mother country, Britain, sacrifice their interests to the cause of African self-determination.
Their objectives was to hold on to Kenya, which had the largest European population amongst the three East African states, and to make this a white man's country. That was their objective. It was the objective of the settlers, and they were supported by the British government.
When you consider that the people here in Kenya, the masses of the Africans here in Kenya, are probably roughly about the same stage as Great Britain was 500 years ago, we do not think that normal forms of democracy are suitable.
In 1952, when Sir Evelyn Baring arrived as governor, he faced a rising that was to shake colonial rule throughout Africa.
In the face of the intransigence of the settlers and the indecisiveness of the British government, the moderate policies of the KAU, or KAU, as the Kenya African Union was known, seemed to be making little headway.
KAU didn't want to provoke the situation at all. We thought by the normal democratic methods we will get our way. In other words, what we were asking for in this was just really human justice. We asked for more representation in parliament. We asked for more money on education, agriculture, and so on. So for some time, there was a feeling in KAU to continue that sort of struggle. And the others have said, no, this is not going to work, let's fight it out.
One of those who was prepared to fight, if necessary, was Solomon Memia. He had been in politics since the mid-1930s as a leader of the Kikuyu Central Association. When this party was banned in 1940, Memia took it underground and helped carry it through into the post-war period. We organized a secret political movement when we realized that things were moving too slowly with the Kenya African Union. Our movement was based on an oath, which was intended to give our people courage to fight for our land and for our freedom. The first oath that members of the underground movement were required to take was known as the Oath of Unity. It bound them together and strengthened their support for more militant political action. We used an oath to help people understand what the struggle was about. Many people were cowards. They were frightened of politics. They said it was bad for us to set ourselves against the Europeans. We decided to put courage into them, and to do this, we had to give them an oath and tell them, we want you to be ready to die fighting for this land, fighting the white man until he stops ruling us, until the land he has stolen comes back to us. Then we shall have our freedom and not be ruled badly by the colonial government.
Mercifully, the troubled area in relation to the rest of Africa is a very small one. Even the 4.5 million Africans who live in Kenya outside the Kikuyu territory are not involved. The active terrorists are only a small proportion of the 1.5 million Kikuyu, Embu and Meru people, though because of fear, most of the Kikuyu tribe has aided them.
In and out.
The underground organizers embarked on a campaign to unify the entire African population. The settlers and the colonial government gradually became aware of the oathing ceremonies, and in 1950, the government outlawed the Mau Mau Society, which they said was responsible for administering illegal oaths. The words Mau Mau meant nothing in any language in Kenya. We knew ourselves as the Kiama Jia Kuitia Wiathi, the Freedom Struggle Association. Mau Mau was a name coined by the Europeans to discredit the movement and to confuse the waverers. There was no such thing as Mau Mau. It was an invention of the Europeans.
When the British refused to budge, some Kikuyu formed a secret organization. They lived off the land in the forest under Mount Kenya and called themselves a Land and Freedom Army. Waiwaturi joined them.
I joined Mau Mau because of the hardship. The main problem was that our land had been taken by the white man. Then there was education. The schools we used to go to were closed down and destroyed. So we all came together into groups and took an oath. The African was your brother, but when you see a white man, you should know he is your enemy.
To the settlers and to their allies in the colonial government, the Kenya African Union and Mau Mau were one and the same, and Jomo Kenyatta, Kao's president, was the leader of both.
Most Kikuyu were just as certain. Kenyatta, their leader, ran Mau Mau.
How much did Kenyatta know about the organization of Mau Mau?
I think he knew nothing.
At all?
At all. Kenyatta was among the older generation, so we feared that if he knew much, he may disagree with what we were thinking of doing. So it was only the younger generation which had decided that because all other means have failed, we must use violence.
He was not active in that organization, and we did not want him to be active in that one. He did not know who were leading.
Kenyatta did not know who the leaders were?
No, and he could not say who was steering the wheel.
Kao is not a fighting union that uses fists and weapons, Kenyatta told his followers. If any of you here think that force is good, I do not agree with you. Remember the old saying that he who is hit with a club returns, but he who is hit with justice never comes back. In 1952, the settlers refused to believe a word Kenyatta said. He was the symbol of everything they loathed, the focus of everything they feared. At one point, they even called for his liquidation.
It's very difficult not to conclude that Kenyatta himself was the originator of it.
I was completely convinced that he was the actual leader of the Mau Mau, that he'd started the whole thing, that he was responsible for inventing the oaths that they had to take. I have no doubt that he instituted Mau Mau and kept it going.
I'm quite sure, yes, that he was responsible to start with. I knew perfectly well that headmen were being murdered and their huts set on fire with them locked inside and so on.
He seemed to have a synthesis of modernism and atavism. He seemed to be totally attuned to the background of his people, to their practices, their customs, their superstitions. He knew about Russia and Britain. He was a very broadly informed, human sort of man. I never felt other than dominated by his vibrant personality, a sort of hypnotic masculinity, and one felt enveloped by his warmth and at the same time slightly repelled by his menace.
He had magnetism, absolute magnetism, and he could put anybody to ash by looking at him. And Hitler had the same thing, apparently, as far as his eyes. That man, he had something.
It's the only time in the whole of my life that I actually felt the hair on the back of my neck standing on end. In a way, he appeared to be rather like a very flamboyant black bookmaker, enormous great rings on his fingers, a very ornate stick, and very impressive eyes, rather sort of bored into. Coupled with the fact that you knew he was determined to ruin everything in your district if he could, had a terrible effect on one.
By the middle of 1952, hundreds of thousands of Africans, mostly Kikuyu, had taken the oath of unity. A more militant set of leaders had taken over most of the top offices in Kau. Mass meetings of unprecedented size took place, at which the demands for self-government and for the return of expropriated lands were made with new confidence. The settlers felt threatened by this militancy, but they were more disturbed by the prospect of the British government coming to a political settlement with the Africans, as was happening already in West Africa. Self-government under permanent white leadership had always been the settlers' goal in Kenya. In order to realize that objective, they now embarked upon a campaign to crush African nationalism. At this point, it's very important to look at the chronology of the events which led up to the declaration of the emergency. Sir Philip Mitchell, Kenya's governor since 1944, retired in June 1952. Mitchell had been a thorn in the settlers' side. While they claimed that discontent was growing into revolt, Mitchell was saying that things had never been better. With Mitchell out of the way, and his successor not due to arrive for 3 months, the settlers made their move. On July 10th, Michael Blundell, the leader of the settlers, introduced a motion in the Legislative Council calling for stern measures against a subversive organization which he said was spreading like a disease through the colony. The acting authorities refused to accept this view or admit that new laws were necessary. Over the next few weeks, the settlers held a series of meetings. They threatened to take the law into their own hands unless the government declared a state of emergency, arrested the nationalist leaders, and issued a statement that nationalism on West African lines was not the official policy in Kenya.
Mr. Michael Blundell, leader of the European elected members, a body formed by the white settlers, strongly criticizes as ineffectual the present action being taken by the government. The feeling runs high among the settlers, for it is the ultimate aim of the Mau Mau to drive them all from Africa. Refused audience with the governor, Sir Evelyn Baring. The demonstrators attempt to storm Government House.
Well, I went along to Baring, and he said, you must go out and control the crowd. I will not go out. One day another crowd may demand my going out. When I arrived, the settlers were standing their cigarettes on the arms and faces of the police, the black policemen, to get them clear of the doors so they could smash the doors in. Well, I ordered the police away, and the policeman stood at attention and said, I only take my orders, sir, from the commissioner. And I remember turning round, because you must remember it was terribly intense. I said, where the bloody hell is the commissioner? He was just behind me. And I said, you take your men away. You take your men away. I'll be responsible. Just as we were getting the crowd settled down, the Sultana of Zanzibar, who was naturally a dark-featured woman, came out onto the veranda to look over the crowd. And of course they went mad. I remember one South African woman saying, there, look, they've got the bloody niggers already in the place. The bloody niggers are already in the place.
Now that the killing had been turned on them, the whites armed themselves.
A month or two before the emergency was actually declared, many of us felt something was going to happen. And we had rumors that perhaps Mr. Kenyatta would be arrested, together with the other members of the committee of the Kenya African Union. What was going to happen, of course, we couldn't foresee at that time.
On the 19th of August, the acting governor denied categorically that there was a state of emergency in the colony. The government could not stop nationalism, he said. It could only try to guide it. Now the settlers began to talk of vigilante groups. They began to attribute every crime to Mau Mau. Every murder, every theft, every sullen look, every hostile stare was the work of Mau Mau.
The Mau Mau became a very real threat to the isolated white settlers. Nellie discovered that even Karanga, her cook, had Mau Mau connections. She was worried.
9th of October, 1952. On Tuesday,
poor old Chief Woyohiu got murdered, and another European woman stabbed to death, making the second in a fortnight. So now I'm taking the firearm question seriously and going to the police to be told how to load my revolver. White settlers struggle to preserve their pre-war way of life, in spite of the real situation in Kenya. But homegrown militia and armed settlers could not cope.
The fact that your own cook, who'd been with you for 30, 40 years, could be oathed in a way that he could come and kill you. Unbelievable. You'd been a friend to him, you'd been helpful to his children, you'd done this, that and the other over the years, and yet, happily, one night he would come and slit your throat. This they couldn't understand. They couldn't understand the depth of bitterness.
The Kenya government, more worried by the threat of a settler revolt than an African one, agreed to consider special laws to suppress African politics.
We were not taken by complete surprise, as we knew something was going to be done to try and keep down the movement, which was now taken, have taken tremendous proportion in agitating for self-government.
On September the 16th, several Kenya officials flew to London to persuade the Colonial Office that the proposed laws were necessary to control subversion. This was the first time the British government was informed directly of what was going on. A week later, 7 new ordinances were passed and held ready for the arrival of the governor, whose signature would make them law. On September the 29th, more than 3 months after Mitchell's retirement, the new governor arrived. Sir Evelyn Baring was welcomed at Nairobi Airport by settlers and government officials alike. On September the 30th, Baring was sworn in as governor. On October the 3rd, he signed the new legislation. He was then taken for a brief tour of the rural areas where Mau Mau was allegedly operating. On October the 7th, while Baring was still on tour, the incident for which the settlers had waited took place. Senior Chief Waluhiu, one of the government's most loyal supporters, was assassinated.
Kenyatta had avoided taking sides. In 1952, the British persuaded him to do so. At a mass rally alongside the pro-British chief Waluhiu, he cursed Mau Mau.
I think he was cornered. They forced him to denounce Mau Mau, and I think he did not know what to do about it. So he used a Kikuyu proverb, which said that Mau Mau should go under the roots of the tree, Miriam Ikongoe, and which actually means go into the drains and never to come back. So it was taken very seriously by people.
Kenyatta's curse led the Mau Mau Central Committee to summon him.
When he came, we told him how we are disappointed. In fact, that was the time when the Central Committee introduced itself to him, that we are the Mau Mau Central Committee, we are organizing this and that, and we feel very hurt by your denunciation.
Kenyatta was left in no doubt that if he continued to denounce Mau Mau, they would deal with him.
Kenyatta would have been a very big trouble.
What's
that? Even to the extent of being killed. It was not a joke by that time. There were no going back.
There was the possibility Kenyatta could have been killed?
Yes.
If he had tried to go back?
Yes.
And denounce Mau Mau? What makes you so sure of that?
Well, I know because I was the chief organizer and I know what was people were serious about it within the movement. They had their local people. If they decide somebody will die, then, and a death sentence had been passed by the bench, well, nobody can stop them.
So there were the local district liquidation squads, were there?
Everywhere. They were everywhere. Because, see, there were a lot of traitors, and they had to be
stopped.
In October 1952, Chief Waruhiu, who had stood beside Kenyatta when he cursed Mau Mau, was murdered. Baring had been governor for only a week. Across the grave, he saw Jomo Kenyatta. They did not meet. The whites forced the new governor's hand. Baring declared a state of emergency. Kenyatta was arrested.
The movement has many heads, Baring wrote. We are dealing with a hydra. It is now abundantly clear that we are facing a planned revolutionary movement. If the movement cannot be stopped, there will be an administrative breakdown, followed by bloodshed amounting to civil war. European farmers are very reasonable, but all indications are that there will be a planned assassination of Europeans. Reprisals will then be absolutely inevitable. At this point, 10 days before the emergency began, not one European settler had been killed. On October the 14th, the Secretary of State for the Colonies, Oliver Littleton, approved Baring's request. First the Kenya government, and now the British government, had in effect accepted the settlers' concept of Mau Mau. It remained only to convince the world. On October the 20th, the war began.
British troops poured into Kenya. It seemed that the old guard of the empire still held on, now hopelessly out of step with world opinion. Even back in Britain, people started to question whether all this conflict was justifiable. In the struggle for Kenyan independence, 11,500 Mau Mau were killed. 167 British soldiers and 1,800 civilians, mostly black, also died.
Nairobi police have been supplemented by hundreds of civilians, many of them women, to help round up the Mau Mau bandits. Radio-controlled cars with armored vehicles are used to carry out the army's plans for bringing in all suspects. More than 3,500 have been arrested already. All have to be carefully checked by police security men, for in such a decisive swoop as this, it is all too easy for the innocent to suffer. Not only fanatics fill the ranks of the Mau Mau, many have joined from fear.
It is difficult to describe the sense of relief which overcame me, Michael Blundell later wrote. I felt as if a great load had been lifted from me. As I thought of the pressures which we had exerted earlier and the uncooperative way in which they had been met.
All who carry the mark of the Mau Mau must be hunted out so that peace may come to this troubled colony. At Government House in Nairobi, capital of Kenya, executive members of the council meet the colonial secretary, Mr. Oliver Littleton, to discuss means of ridding their colony of the Mau Mau. For in this land, there is fear of those fanatical natives who aim to drive out the white man and who have murdered many who stood in their path. Mr. Littleton visits the people who live in their dark shadow, and from Chief Njeri, hears how his two fellow chieftains were killed by the terrorists. Mr. Littleton learns of the Mau Mau's threats on the lives of Catholic missionaries. And in the Nyanza province, he talks with elders of the Kikuyu tribe, from which the Mau Mau drew hundreds of recruits, many of whom have now been arrested. Britain has brought much good to Kenya. Her standards of living are growing still higher as more of her people learn the lessons that the white man has to teach. But if the Mau Mau were to succeed in their mission, then the natives fear their colony might easily return to its former primitive state. Continuing his tour to Mumias, the colonial secretary is presented with a hand-carved stool as the natives' token of appreciation that the British people are deeply concerned with their troubles. Now Mr. Littleton returns to Britain to lay before the government his plans for ridding Kenya of the menace of the Mau Mau.
Having authorized the state of emergency, It was necessary for the colonial secretary, on behalf of the British government, to discover against whom or what it was directed.
Mr. Littleton, you said in the House of Commons last week that you were going out to Kenya to see for yourself and to discuss the measures now being taken to suppress the activities of the Mau Mau. Now, can you tell me more or less how these people operate?
Well, the Mau Mau is a secret society which enforces membership by compelling, very often compelling people to take these oaths, and that's how it's built up its membership.
Now, how many of the 5.5 million Africans in Kenya are members of the Mau Mau?
It's impossible to say. There's some estimates put it as high as 100,000 out of 5.5 million, and some much lower. And of course, you can't tell how many of the, say, 100,000 are voluntary members or how many have joined from intimidation.
We had made representations a week after the Colonial Secretary, Oliver Littleton, came here to have talks with him. We met the Governor and the Colonial Secretary. The Governor at the time was Evelyn Baring. And that was a very futile interview because I think they'd made up their minds before they saw us as to what would be the answer. They wouldn't argue anything with us. We'd made several proposals. And one of the most interesting things about that, the last memorandum submitted by the Kenya African Union at that meeting, we never asked for independence. We asked that half the legislature should be African and the other half non-African. We asked for the elimination of the color bar. We asked for more educational facilities. We asked for more money to be spent on African agriculture, but we did not ask for independence. It was all thrown overboard.
Mau Mau is not a child of economic pressure, Mr. Littleton told the House of Commons on November the 7th. It feeds not on economic discontent, but on a perverted nationalism and a sort of nostalgia for barbarism.
All told, 32 settlers were killed by Mau Mau during the emergency. The manner of their deaths created an atmosphere of fear and vengeance. Against this background, Kenyatta and five others were charged with managing Mau Mau.
Why have a trial? We didn't want a trial. We thought it was a waste of time and any big publicity to Mau Mau, which a detention order would never have had. As it was, that trial went on for months and months and months. And so the people suddenly said, well, this chap must be a good chap. Now he's okay. He's been tried by the white people. They all thought that it's a rigged trial. And by God, it was.
Pressure from the House of Commons forced the British to hold a trial. The police searched Kenyatta's papers for evidence, but they found no link with Mau Mau. The administration needed a conviction. After careful consideration, they selected Judge Ransley Thacker to hear the case.
Thacker was brought back from retirement on a very high fee to do the dirty work for the government. In fact, before that, one registrar and a senior judge told me that they had in fact been offered or asked to take this case on condition that they would promise that Kenyatta would be convicted, and they had refused to do so. Thacker confided in his clerk to say that doesn't matter what the defense people say, they can do what they want, but I will make a cast iron judgment. I will make sure that my judgment is so well couched and so well written that even a court of appeal will not change it. I'm going to make sure that they convicted and given the maximum sentence. He decided this right from the start. There's no doubt about it.
The battles between the judge and Kenyatta's lawyers attracted world attention. What was not known was the arrangement between Judge Thacker and the government.
Thacker, simultaneously while conducting the trial, was carrying on a correspondence with the government about special payments to be made to him, as he thought it might be dangerous to live in Kenya after bringing in a conviction, and therefore he might have to leave the country and retire somewhere else, and finally was paid a sum of £20,000. All sorts of obstacles were put in our way. Defense witnesses were threatened. In fact, in one particular case, when we brought about 10 or 12 persons to prove an alibi of Kenyatta, or prove that in fact he did not do what he was supposed to do, including some ministers from the church and the chief and others. They were all arrested as soon as they gave evidence.
One key prosecution witness, Rawson Macharia, gave crucial evidence that helped convict Kenyatta. 5 years later, he swore to a court that he had been bribed to tell lies.
He had written letters from the government, which he showed me, that he would be sent to England, he would be educated there, his family would be supported, and when he came back, he'd be given a job. At that stage, I decided to take an affidavit from him, in which he said that the whole of his evidence was invented, that the other 10 witnesses whose names he'd given were telling the truth, and he'd been committing perjury.
Macharia's changed evidence was not believed by the courts. Whatever the truth, he had helped secure heavy sentences.
Kenyatta was found guilty of inciting Mau Mau and imprisoned in a remote part of Kenya for the 7 years of the emergency. It was meant to wipe him from Kikuyu consciousness. It was a fatal mistake. At a stroke, he became a martyr to the Mau Mau cause, and the British lost the one moderate leader who had the power to unite Kenya.
The real violence of Mau Mau took place after Kenyatta was arrested. And I believe by arresting the hierarchy of Mau Mau, you put inside those people who were perhaps, their aims were peaceful means, or moderately peaceful, and all the thugs took over. And the killings, the real killings of Mau Mau, took place after Kenyatta had been arrested.
When Mr. Kenyatta was arrested and the emergency was declared, and this persecution of the people meted out by the British government and British forces that were here, that made the people even more determined to continue the fight and to pursue the fight using force. We had no other alternative.
Kenyatta's conviction persuaded hundreds of young Kikuyu of the need for violent struggle. With few arms and no allies, they operated as small gangs in the forests.
This is part of the Kikuyu Reserve, the chief trouble center in Kenya, where for many months the Mau Mau have held loyal Africans in a grip of terror. To Fort Hall, a lonely outpost in the heart of the reserve, comes Major General Hind, the Director of Operations Against the Terrorists, to inspect the men whose job it is to track down the murderers and bring them to justice. Kikuyu hutments have been taken over as command posts, and in one of these, Major General Hind checks up his campaign tactics with local officers. These outposts are in perpetual danger from the Mau Mau, who creep in from the countryside to attack the loyal villagers.
Kikuyu, who had prospered under British rule, sent their men to join the Home Guard, armed and trained by the government. The Mau Mau rebellion had become a civil war.
For the next 7 years, the central province of Kenya was sealed off from the outside world. No one could leave or enter it without an official permit. The Kenya government was thus virtually free of public scrutiny of their conduct of the war. They closed down the Kikuyu independent schools, depriving 30 to 50,000 children of education. They permitted the settlers to expel tens of thousands of Kikuyu laborers from farms in the highlands and repatriated them to the already overcrowded reserves. They activated the Kenya Regiment and the Kenya Police Reserve, both manned by settlers.
The response of the Europeans at that time was, of course, frankly theatrical. There was far too much carrying of guns, slapping pistols on the bars, wearing outre sort of louche clothes. At the time, we called them the Kenya cowboys, and of course they loathed that, but that is exactly what they were. While they were terrified in one sense, they were profiting by the situation in another, in that all the extrovert nature of the old-fashioned Happy Valley Kenyan was able to find its expression. by the carrying of the six-shooter on the hip, the slamming of doors, the sort of general John Wayne behavior of everybody in the country.
I remember myself as when I was in Athaya, which is in the southern half of Nyeri district, and I'd only been in the country a few months, hearing that the police officer in the next door division, which was in another district, had lined five people up against the wall and shot them. I wrote a letter complaining about this to the district officer in Nyeri, and was informed that he had passed my letter to the district commissioner in Fort Hall. And that was the last I heard of it, and no one heard any more about that particular incident. I remember, too, the son of a very liberal Kenya European. He was in the Kenya regiment, and he came to my office in Nyeri and proceeded to kick onto the floor a hapless Kikuyu with the announcement that this person had taken the oath, and what was I going to do about it? I'm merely speaking of these two incidents as symptomatic of something which was much graver, and this was, I think, there's no doubt about it, systematic torture and brutality and an attitude of shoot to kill, which was endemic, certainly, in the central province for the first year and a half of the emergency.
The oppression was very bitter, I can assure you that. British troops at one time were paid a gratuity for every mama they killed, and they had to bring in the man's hand to prove that they had killed a man. And apart from British troops, the local settlers took the law in their own hands, formed themselves into groups with their guns, and went out shooting people out of hand.
...80,000 suspects were detained and interrogated, including Wangugu Gichunga.
Mutu anaitwa pale kwa Rain, mana wamekuja wanakuja moja moja.
We would all be in a line. They'd call the detainees one by one.
Wewe. Unajua Mau Mau? No.
Are you Mau Mau? No.
Wewe umekula kiapo?
Have you taken an oath?
Hapa.
No.
Unaweza fanya nini?
What will you do if we send you home?
Hakuna?
Nothing.
Kuna kitu. Sema.
Tell us if you are Mau Mau.
This brought a tremendous reaction from the people as such. You may call it a revolution. Yes, it was in opposition to government's action.
I speak the truth and vow before our God. And by this Batuni oath of our movement, which is called the movement of fighting, that if I am called on to kill for our soil, if I am called on to shed my blood for it, I shall obey, and I shall never surrender. I speak the truth and vow before our God, that if the people of the movement come to me by day or night, and if they ask me to hide them, I shall do so, and I shall help them. I speak the truth and vow before our God, that I shall never take away the woman of another man, that I shall never walk with prostitutes, that I shall never steal anything belonging to another person in the movement. And if I transgress against any of the vows that I have thus consciously made, I shall agree to any punishment that the movement shall decide to give me. And if I fail to do these things, may this oath kill me. The revolutionary movement that the government had claimed existed in October had been created within 4 months by the very measures designed to suppress it. Thousands of men and women reacted to the oppression by moving into the forests of Mount Kenya and the Aberdare Mountains to become not Mau Mau, but the Land Freedom Army.
Mau Mau, no Zambia.
Ona ngaragu ne kwari tondu gutiakire irio no githaka na itwacokire tukimenyara heho na irio ningi ni twagicionaga na thina na tukomiriria ni undu wa kwenda gwitia wiyathi tukona gutiru ndungi ungituma tiga no turuire mbara yo nyene.
The British used the police and army to round up suspects from the Kikuyu villages.
They dropped 50,000 tons of bombs to try to destroy their camps. The Mau Mau who tried to shoot down the British planes were celebrated as folk heroes.
We believed that Kenya was our country and we had the right to rule ourselves and not to be ruled by foreigners. And we believed that the white settlement in the highland, which was set aside exclusively for the white settlers, was our own land.
We had to supply, get arms for the people who were fighting. We had to organize we had to rob these arms actually and ammunition from various police stations and so on and supply them to the people who were fighting. We had to supply food to them. We had a whole string of informers. We even had informers in Government House who produced files to us of what was going on in Government House. We really, you could get hold of the files, read them, and replace them in Government House.
In
the Central Committee, we had a slogan,
This meant that once you promised to do something, you must do it, whatever the consequences.
If you were ordered, go and bring the head of so-and-so, you would do it without questioning. Whatever you were ordered to do, you obeyed. That was the real meaning of say and act. A lot had been spoken, but little had been done. Now it was the carrying out of the promises that was important to us. It was action that meant something, not words. Say and act.
Within 6 months of the start of the emergency, the Land Freedom Army numbered about 10,000. They were actively supported by hundreds of thousands of peasants in the settled areas surrounding the forests. Armed only with homemade or stolen weapons, they quickly took the offensive. They attacked police posts, loyalist villages, British Army units, and occasionally white settlers. More than anything, it was the killing of whites by blacks that was exploited in propaganda and inflated in paranoia. The image of Mau Mau as the white man's nightmare is the strongest image to come out of the emergency. But in fact, the planned assassination of settlers, which Sir Evelyn Baring had anticipated, never took place. Only 32 of Kenya's 40,000 white settlers were killed by Africans during 4 years of active fighting. Yet each European death became a further justification for massive retribution. What the settlers had once elevated to the status of a revolutionary movement, they now debased into something so evil that it was worse than the evils required to eradicate it.
I've just arrived from Kenya, where for over 6 months we've been in the throes of a battle against Mau Mau, which is really another name for a struggle against the destruction of civilization and law and order and everything that we hold of value. It has been engineered by unscrupulous agitators and is really a challenge to us, all that we value, and the Christian faith.
Over the course of 4 years, more than 15,000 Africans lost their lives. According to official statistics, less than 2,500 were victims of Mau Mau. The others, more than 80% of those who died, were killed by government forces.
This episode of History File was produced in Cardiff by BBC Wales. It was developed.